How close in the 80s did we come to losing you as a band? Was there a time when it wasn't there, period?
No. I mean, there was a time when you didn't particularly want to do it, and I dare say it was probably correct at the time. If you don't want to do something, you don't do it.
Were you surprised when it all came together as well as it did? Or did you know in your heart that
I knew it would just be there.
Considering the road that you have traveled, and you have been one lucky bloke, you've been in the middle of some amazing music. This whole thing just culminates beautifully with the Stones, the gig, the history, all that stuff.
It's a wonderful institution that keeps rolling. That's what I like about it, you know. You could tell if someone in the band didn't really want to do it anymore, that would be horrible.
Terrible.
That would be terrible, yeah. And luckily, you know, everyone is still driven with the same drive that was there since they started, I think. Even though I wasn't there at the beginning, I mean, they just love to play.
Sense of it in the last 3 or 4 years, the musical influences, a lot of angst, a lot of anger, and then you come back in with Voodoo Lounge, an album that is not about those things, and I find it amazingly refreshing.
Thanks. I don't really understand. I don't really listen to the record. I haven't sat down and listened to it and said, well, this is what the overriding emotional pattern of it is. I think it's probably not anger, but I don't know what it is. Probably a lot of different things.
You ever wonder why some reviewers completely get it and some don't? Well, somebody hears it.
Depends which mood you're in when you're listening.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, it's very subjective listening to music or watching a movie. You know, have to be very careful. If you're looking at something about work and you're doing it late at night when you're tired, you tend to be much more negative about it. Yeah. As if you look at it fresh, more open-minded. So, you know, if you're reviewing your record and you're kind of at the end of the day and your old lady's giving you a hard time or something, it's very, very subjective listening to music. And that's the way it should be.
You just do what you do. I mean, what else is there? I mean, I'm not trying to impress people or anything. Everybody blessed me very early on in my life with... hey, we like what you do, you know? And that's basically what it's not that I'm trying to just please people out there. I don't really, and never have sort of, what were they like, what's the flavor of the month sort of thing. But I've always taken that first thing to heart, which is, hey, we like what you do, and so I'll just keep on doing it, you know, and see if I can get it better, maybe. To do, and it's a different kind of album. It's not, as I say, it's not just the usual live album off a tour, because we've done so much of that.
So this time we thought we'd do a slightly different approach, and we started off by thinking, well, if we do some clubs, we can record the clubs, and if we do some acoustic set, you know, which we'd have been doing already in America, and if we do record all the rehearsals
like we did in Tokyo and Lisbon. Each night we took a studio on a day off, which turned out to be a day on. We did 18 songs each session, like just boom, boom, like that, and it was really good fun.
Let's pass through the plate.
Okay, we go
in. And again, once the pressure was off, guys figure they're not making a record. It's more like rehearsing. You know, suddenly you've got another sort of charm about it, and another, a more relaxed feel, and you could add some things to those songs that you didn't do when you first cut them, And it's very difficult to do on stage just because of the sheer size of it. And so it's a kind of nice middle way between, you know, it's far, I mean, it's, for me, it's a far better record than if we'd been, I had to be here talking to you about Voodoo Lounge Live, you know, I mean, it'd be like, oh, again. You know.
But you see, your bandmates say, if Charlie goes, we're packing it in. If he's not going to play with us, there's no need to go back out
well,
and do this
anymore. That's a whole other thing. That's not what I mean.
Well.
And I don't believe that, but I mean.
well,
people will play anyway, whether they play. I don't think anything could stop Keith playing. He's going to die playing. He will.
I know.
I mean, we're going to be playing for a year now, and at the end of it, I'm going to say thank you very much. He won't. He'll be looking around for the next gig. I know he does it every time, you know. He hates stopping.
There's an old line, you must have heard this, that, you know, one day the end of the world is going to come, and the only living thing that will remain is, yeah.
Me and the cockroach, right?
Yeah.
Well, look out, cockroach. Because I'll eat it.
You know, Charlie says, even after the Stones have done, that Keith will be so wound up, he'll just continue playing, and he'll look around, and he'll be...
On his own.
Yeah, that's right.
And I'll be sitting somewhere writing some music and he'll be still be playing at the last gig. Are we still playing Jumping Jack Flash?
Do you ever ask yourself how long you're going to do this? Do you ever think to yourself, is there an end to this? Your desire to go and play and write songs and
no,
be a Rolling Stone?
No, the end to this would be drop dead on stage. Rock till you drop.
Hey, you guys can move over, please.